This is me at my mum and dad's house. Say hello.
Hello.
Say welcome to the No Name Sunday Show.
Welcome to the No Name Sunday Show.
Whoa, welcome everybody. Say, first it's who let the dogs out.
Yeah.
Say it.
Yeah, first let the dogs out.
Who let the dogs out?
First who let the dogs out?
Right, now sing. Who let the dogs out?
Me? Yeah. That? No, yeah. I can't.
You can. Who let the dogs out?
Who let the dogs out?
Oof, 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 oof. There you go. You just opened the show and you didn't even know it.
Yeah, great.
I've gone beret. We've gone beret. We're going double beret today.
Yeah.
I think for each piece of camera, we're going to change our berets.
I'm testing my oxygen levels and my heartbeats.
What is your oxygen level?
Well, I'll tell you in a minute. Yeah. It's coming up. Oh my gosh, it's low.
What is it?
It's 87. I'm going. 88.
We all need a new battery.
I'll have to breathe.
Okay, breathe out. In.
God, heartbeats are gone as well. Oh dear. This is not. I'm glad that I was, you know, I thought casually I'd examined it. I'm on my way out.
Oh well, oh, at least you got one more show out of him.
I wouldn't believe it. I'm up to 90 on oxygen, but the heartbeats have gone. 29, that's not normal.
You are officially dead.
Dad, do you think it might be your battery?
Huh?
Do you think it might be your battery?
I'll start
Why
again.
Why didn't I try it?
I'm down to 27, the heartbeats.
Let me try.
Hopefully he'll still be here for the next section of the show. It's a bit more of a nighttime shoot today. We've got back from Loose Women and then we had lots of other filming things to do, so it's a bit later, it's a bit darker. So it doesn't feel very Sunday. It's Friday evening, actually, I'm gonna be honest. And I am cooking. I've wanted to do this for ages, actually, for this Sunday show, because I saw a really good Instagram post of this and I thought I've got to make that for the family guests. And it is nachos.
Ooh.
So we're gonna have a bed of tortilla chips. Then on top of that, we're gonna have a spicy beef with cumin, smoked paprika, garlic, red kidney beans, chili, you don't have to add the chili, and onions. I don't usually use red onions, but I like a bit of red onion in this. So then the beef will go over the nachos. Then on top of that, we'll put cheese and we'll melt the cheese. Then on top of that, we'll go avocado, sour cream, and jalapenos. We're gonna pretend we're in Mexico or LA, because that's where we've had them. This is a bastardization of many different.
Your face looks different.
Well, it's because I've got makeup on.
No, no, your eyes look smaller.
Smaller? It's because I've got kohol inside my eyeline.
I beg your pardon.
Kohol. So I'm just putting a little bit of red onion. I don't usually fry red onion because I find it doesn't soften up. I don't mind if there's a little bite in it. I mean, actually, if it wasn't for Mark, because I know Mark will love to eat this. It's a great Friday night little binge food. But great Sunday morning too, guys, if anyone's with a hangover. So sorry if this is boring, guys, but you know how Mark insists.
Well, I do, but your hand always covers the onion.
Well, I mean, I can't do it. I'm not Jamie Oliver.
Why not?
I'm just a home cook hacking a couple of onions.
Frying onions?
No.
Browning your meat?
Yeah.
Don't tell John Waite that.
No, but this is a different moment because this meat isn't being braised. It's just being fried. We're not cooking it for hours.
Oh.
So I'm going to do it in two batches.
That's how the dogs always come out when mince comes out. Look at that, look. Straight
I love
away.
A bit of mince.
Boom. She just knows when there's mince. You won't like that, Chi-Chi. It's onion. It's onion. Chi-Chi, do you want some mince? So,
what's just gotta wait till that starts to cook. Mincy pincy, mincy pincy, mincy pincy.
A friend of mine once put mince in another friend of mine's tuba.
Why?
So that when he played it, it flew out, went everywhere.
Weird. You know some weird people.
Yeah, he didn't mince his words though.
Oh, Mark. Awful. Exactly. Go away and come back once it's all browned. I'm going to do it and then I'm going to brown the next lot. So go away.
Boring.
Go away. Okay, while that's brown, while that other lot's brown, I'm just going to cut up.
That lot.
Some pepper. We did have a red pepper, but I ate it by accident because I forgot I was doing this dish, and it would look really nice, a bit of red pepper
How
in
it. How can you eat a red pepper
so
by accident?
If you've got, a meaning that I forgot that I needed it for this dish.
Oh.
So if really I would prefer it if we were using a red and a green pepper. Right. So my meat is brown. We want to keep all those nice meaty flavours in the pan. If you're vegan or vegetarian, this is the point you would start. You would imagine we haven't put any beef. You would double up your peppers, so maybe put two or three green peppers, a couple of red peppers, a couple of onions. Onions go in first. A couple of cloves of garlic. Add as much garlic or as little garlic or no garlic. Lovely. It's usually the point that one of the girls will come down and go, Mom, I'm hungry. Starving. Just gonna let that cook down for a few minutes. Put some, do you want it hot, Mark? Do you want the seeds?
Yeah.
Ooh, all this pith and pith and pips, are you sure?
No.
It's not Scotch bonnet.
Chi-Chi, you do not want to eat that, Chi-Chi.
No, Chi-Chi.
You don't.
Now, I'm going to do it fairly chunky because we don't mind if we get a little bite of this. Quite want us to get a bite of, you might be thinking, whoa, that's a bit chunky. You want to make yours really finely chopped, you can, but I kind of want that flash of red and a bit of a bite of chilli. Isn't that pretty now?
Yeah.
Just going to add a little more olive oil because it's going darker than I want. I want it to just cook nice and slow. And now I'm going to add to that some cumin seeds, about a teaspoon. You'll notice I often add cumin when I'm having beans. Why? Because it helps cut down the wind, and actually just the flavours. It's amazing how Mother Nature works. She created cumin for the beans she created to counteract the wind. Just going to let that cook for a couple of minutes, cook down a bit.
That looks really nice.
Yeah, it's been cooking for a couple of minutes. You might think, why are you putting these in so late? This isn't like, you know, a soft pepperonata ratatouille. We want a little bit of bite.
Did you put anything else other than pepper in?
Yeah, you don't have to put pepper. You can put corn.
Tomato?
You can put tomato. This isn't yes, you can totally put tomato. So now I'm going to put the beef back in. So we're going to put some tomato puree in. You would probably put more tomatoes if you were doing this vegan. If you're doing vegan or vegetarian, actually, you could use fake mints, soy mints. I don't want big blobby bits of tomato, really, but I don't think it's nice. Splash of water. Oh my God, my chopping board's on fire. Twist of pepper, oh that beautiful chopping board. Good sprinkling of salt. Don't you think the jar is lovely? Look at that, not the jar, the tin. I don't know what it's like.
Let me see the tin.
Oh!
Hold it.
It's gorgeously smoky. Oh, I'm going to put a big heaped teaspoonful of that. Oh, this is going to make it so smoky with the cumin and everything. It's going to be delish. Yummy, yummy, yummy. And then right at the end, once it's cooked, I'm going to let it cook for about 20 minutes. I'm going to add in the kidney beans, and then we start building our nachos.
Hey.
Guacamole and everything else. Okay. Ready? I'm going to add one of these beef jelly things. Things with this, you can make this up, batch it up, and put it in the freezer. And then, like, if you've got a Saturday night sofa movie night, or whatever, you just get it out, and if you can't be bothered to make guacamole, you can literally just do chopped avocado. So if you were doing this vegetarian or vegan, I really like these organic mushroom stock cubes. Okay, I'm just gonna put a bit more water, and then I'm gonna turn it right down and just let it bubble away. That's smelling really nice. I added a bit of water here and there as it was drying, but you don't want it very saucy, because it's going to go on top of the nacho, so I'm even going to cook a bit more of that sauce away. But meanwhile, I'm going to put in my can of red kidney beans. You don't want to overcook them, you're just literally heating them through. They don't need loads of cooking, but they like to take, I like them to have a little while in the sauce so they can take on the flavor. Now this might seem a lot of fat for a nachos, but this is a dinner, this is a perfect sofa supper, perfect hangover food. As I say, make it up, put it in the freezer. I wouldn't put the beans in. I would just add the beans in when you heat up the beef, because why freeze them? You don't need to. So they're just gonna sit in the sauce. Now I'm gonna add my little extra secret ingredient. You don't have to do this. Don't worry if you haven't got it, but a little grated dark chocolate.
Cooking like the Aztecs.
Adds another layer. We've got that smoky, we've got the cumin, we've got the smoky paprika, the cocoa, the onion, the garlic, the chili, the peppers. Wow. So I've got some tortilla chips, lightly salted. We don't really want them flavoured, I don't think. I think it'd be a bit much. We could spoil the flavours if we put them to meat. Remember that day when the sub said, why does Mark get told off when he eats things, remember?
Yeah.
Because I buy stuff for particular recipes. And we're gonna put our beef on top. I'm doing a mega one.
This is great for a sporting event.
I knew you'd like this.
Great for like watching American football or
yeah,
baseball.
A movie night.
Yeah, movie night.
You just put it on the table in the middle and everyone takes their. So then we put the cheese on top.
I love the way that there's a sort of lucky dip of what flavours you're going to get exactly. each time you go in.
Exactly. Isn't it's it? Just, we always get this when we, in the days when we used to go to LA, this would be what we would get, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
I think we've only ever had it in America. Have we?
I don't know, I've always used to have it in Mexican.
Right, in it Ooh. Goes, under the grill. Now, be careful, because you don't want it to burn. You just want it to go nice and squidgy. Off we go.
Nacho stars.
Nachos! And nachos cheese! And nachos cheese! And nachos! And nachos! And nachos cheese! And nachos cheese! And nachos cheese! Okay, I'm going to make some guacamole to go on top. A couple of avocados. This isn't going to be super special guacamole with all the like the chopped chives and the pestle and mortar. This is just a bit of a bish bash bosh.
A functional guac. One. Functional yeah. guac.
Ooh, functional guac. But I'm just going to make it really simple. Squeeze of lime. Whoops. Squeeze of lime. Slippery. Salt. Some chopped parsley. Coriander is better, but Mark hates it. Bang. And now we're going to get out our nachos. Oh, yum. Look at that, guys. Look at that. What do you reckon?
Yum.
So first of all, I'm going to put some avocado, the guacamole, the quick guac, speedy guac. Some sour cream. And last but not least, some jalapeno. So look, the cheese and the beef and the guac and the sour cream and the jalapeno. Oh my god. Tonight's a write off Mark. You can reach it all. Oh my god, it's so good! Time for the memes, guys. Time for the memes. Oh my god, it's not something I could just, it's a pillow of loveliness, Mark.
So that is the bit that's great, but you just don't know what you're gonna get.
You haven't got anything.
I have.
Doesn't look like it. Get two and scoop. That's better. Try one of those jalapenos, they're so good. Oh my god. Okay, Dad, say now it's time for the memes.
Now it's time for the meals.
Memes.
What does meme mean?
That is a question we're all still trying to answer.
I've got a curl. I've got Superman curl.
Ready.
Welcome to the funny stuff, the funny shit, the stuff that makes the kids go, get real!
Me hearing about lockdown too.
I don't want to play any more games. I'm fucking gamed out. I've had enough of playing games. Fucking hell. I don't want to play any more games.
She's so funny, can I see it again?
I don't want to play any more games. I'm fucking gamed out. I've had enough of playing games. Fucking hell. I don't want to play any more games.
She's one of those people who swears so brilliantly. Isn't
she?
You know, like a good swearer.
Yeah. Love Island Jamaica would be the most entertaining TV.
My Nyla! My Nyla's not missing as a wicked young marshal!
recoupling will have man like this.
Oh!
So like our family, isn't it?
Yeah, it is.
It's like nothing by half.
When you're laughing in a voice note, realise you aren't recording now. Have to fake the laugh.
That's me.
It is you.
Hello.
This is so funny.
Hello, welcome to my YouTube channel, guys. Today I am going to make a new video, so please I want to reach 1 million likes. So please,
bless him. Obviously, there's no other word for subscribe. Yeah. Maybe it's just a unique YouTube language word. That's so cute. It's a bit like your mum with vocabulary.
Yeah, it is.
Vocabulary.
Uni room tour gone wrong.
So this is a little cupboard in that to put like a couple kitchen things. There's the microwave, the stove, the oven. Oh my days! Oh my days!
Okay, give me that.
It's
the way he reacts.
Like a couple kitchen things. There's the microwave, the stove, the oven.
That's so cute.
Oh my days.
I wouldn't know what to
do. Oh my God, sometimes landlords leave it like that so they know that you find it and then they charge you. Nasty little bastards.
Corona after 10 p.m. from Thursday.
Oh, you lucky as fuck, bro. I would have fucked you up, bro.
I mean, that's what they'd have you think,
that's
isn't
how
it?
They make us think.
Yeah, it's chasing us down the street come 10 fucking p.m. Like the virus knows boundaries.
Right. After you said you were going to shower next and you hear someone else turn the water on.
So true.
Pop stuff at 10:01 p.m.
Taser.
Yeah.
She frightens the hell out of me, that woman.
Oh yeah, so like, you know how it's a 10 p.m. curfew, obviously, and people say, when it's 9:59 p.m. and I'm not back in ends. It's Kanye.
That's so funny. But I genuinely want to know where he goes.
It's Kanye. So funny. Hulk hands.
I want to do that.
So funny.
I want to do that. I dressed as Captain America once to pick up Nadia from supermarket.
Boris, these restrictions are for 6 months, everyone in the UK.
Oh, fuck this, I'm out of here. Get that fire exit door. I'm off. Oh, fuck this, I'm out of here. Get that fire exit door. I'm off.
So funny.
You ready?
I'm ready.
You said that with some determination.
I'm ready.
Okay. Whenever you're ready.
I'm ready.
Okay.
I'm ready.
Whenever you're ready.
It's so funny.
I'm ready. Are you ready? I'm ready.
This girl literally falls. the after lockdown too. He has 3.5 metric tons of raw sexual aggression. Look at his face.
Oh my god. His nose.
Smiling.
Oh my god.
And then there's this one.
Babe. Babe.
Telling my husband it's late for work too.
Why are you still in bed? Wake up. Are you not going to work today? Baby, it's 8 a.m.
8 o'clock.
Babe, are you going to work or not?
I am.
It's 8 o'clock.
Are you serious? My phone's dead. Why are you recording? Are you joking me? You're taking a mic.
It's like 2 a.m.
Oh my god, that's taking your life into your own hands.
I'd be so angry. This is, you know, I showed you before this video of a Zoom lesson and like one of the kids pretending to be kidnapped.
Yes.
There's been another one.
Suggestion about moving paragraphs around even. Do we need to call the police?
Oh my god, it's the way he watches it happen.
I know, and watch me.
Did you guys just see Tyler get kidnapped?
Do we need to call the police?
I'd show you this, but I don't know if you get... I'll see if you get it. It's about Twilight. Because basically when Twilight came out, like loads of people that were... All the people that were obsessed with Twilight would always come into school pretending like they were still in the film and you'd just never believe them. So, one day after seeing Twilight. It's a vampire. Oh my god, okay, I got
bit. Oh, that is funny. So wanting the attention.
Yeah, that's
amazing. Oh, they were Rick Rock solid, brilliantly.
I've got one more. Oh. poor dog in this video. Look what the dog does in the
Oh!
I know! He like my. That would so happen.
He tries to wag his tail as he goes through the air.
Like, he tries to pause himself. I don't know why this made me laugh. It was just so British to me that it made me laugh.
Fucking weirdo. Right, you're not going to get off with me. You're going to go, do you want a bet? Fuck off. Want a bet or what? Fucking weirdo.
It's the beginning that makes me laugh so much when they're talking.
You laugh like me.
Right, you're not going to get off with me. You're going to go, do you want a bet? Fuck off. Do you want a bet or what? Fucking weirdo.
Oh,
the sudden
realisation.
Oh, that's great.
When you say you don't drink in the UK.
Why are you drinking? I don't really drink. How's that work? What do you mean? What do you do if you're feeling happy, or sad, or nervous, or bored?
I don't understand the question.
How do you tell people what you really think of them?
I just don't.
Okay, that's mental.
So how do you get off with someone?
We just go for a coffee.
Yeah, but how do you have sex with them?
We just take our clothes off?
Without being drunk?
Yes. But you're stoned, yeah? No? It's perfectly natural.
Oh, that's very clever. And that's funny. That goes to the heart of the problem.
Yeah, yeah.
Of life.
Yeah.
Generally. Very funny. Very funny. Very funny!
So there has been,
Hiatus.
A hiatus. What, Betty?
Well, what, hernia? No. I'm sorry, I think you are dying because I'm 97.
And?
I don't know, what's that one? The 61?
Too much technology.
The pulse rate is 61.
Yeah, yeah. What's that?
I don't know, I think I'm alive. But I've got enough oxygen anyway.
Yeah, but you tell me the heart rate.
Is that the middle one?
Yeah, no, there are two, the top one.
The pulse rate is 58.
You're 58?
And the PI is 6.4 and the oxygen is 98.
Well, 58 is not so hot, so no.
I know.
Yeah, give it a...
So, how are you? How are you feeling, Dad?
I'm feeling okay, but I don't know what the machine will do. Because, you know, we live by the machine now.
Okay, so now it's...
Whoa, lovely. Yeah.
What are you now?
98 and 75.
Oh my God.
Perfecto.
You could do a dance.
Are you doing it on the same finger?
On the same finger, yeah.
Because you could have one dead
this
finger.
This is the one never left me now.
Show the subs your good finger.
Huh? And this is the one. The best you can have.
So guys, for those of you who saw that we uploaded one of our old ones, do you remember the news pre-COVID? When it was just a distant drumbeat in China?
I haven't seen that old episode, but yeah,
it's
amazing.
It's really bizarre.
When we think back to how we used to do these before COVID.
Yeah. And it came from a place of just doing that Johnny Vaughan top-tastic headline, top-tastic stupidity, with that kind of the sun sort of voice. So I'm leading with that brilliantly reputable publication, The Daily Star on Sunday. We are not happy. Get it? We are not happy. And look, there's a bunch of clowns there. Boris in a clown outfit, Matt Hancock in a stupid clown outfit. So the brand new app, which I diligently downloaded onto my phone, is useless. The NHS COVID-19 test and trace app was branded a shambles as it emerged it hadn't been able to record tens of thousands of tests carried out by the NHS.
Every day there's more news we can't believe, eh, girls?
It's an app fail. Absolutely awful. Absolutely atrocious.
Absolutely unbearable. But and you know what, though, guys? We would still urge you to download that app.
Absolutely.
Because once they've got it up and running, it will be the game changer. The countries that are dealing with coronavirus are the countries that have got their track and trace.
I'm still very unclear about it, though, because I keep turning it on thinking it's doing that really nice pulsy search and it'll tell me something. But it will only tell you something if someone has done a particular type of test, and if it's a test that has a certain type of number that can be recognised. It's very, there are many stipulations.
Well, and also, it's only telling you for places where you've scanned in.
Well, I tried scanning in a restaurant, but that wasn't NHS approved.
Oh.
So I tried it on the app, and it said, doesn't recognise this isn't an NHS QR. So can you only test it in NHS? I mean, it seems so ludicrously administrative again. It's just get it. So just come on.
A little bit of showbiz.
A little bit of
Little Mix are ready to take on Simon Cowell, who was famously their manager, by launching their own BBC talent show. Apparently went out last night.
It's going to be an absolute flop.
The girl won ITV's X Factor in 2011. Well, don't say that.
Well, it's just the BBC can't do this kind of thing. They just can't. Every time they've tried to do a big, shiny, floor entertainment show other than Strictly, it doesn't work.
Well, there's another episode today at 6:45 if you want to check it out on BBC One, if you want to give Simon Cowell a bit of a nudge.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I'm all for a bit of competition, but it never ceases to amaze me how the BBC just get things wrong. We talk a lot about students, and my heart is going out to students, and I'm pleased to see, although we were talking about it on our coffee moaning, these are photos of students stuck in their accommodation in Glasgow, unable to go out. We came all this way to start a new life, the misery of Glasgow's lockdown freshers. And so they have been offered a rent rebate, some of them. Give us our money back. Universities face demands to return fees as 3,000 lockdown students miss out on face-to-face teaching. So I do think...
Face-to-face everything.
Face-to-face everything. And, you know, they're putting their signs up. You said there are cases of people being asked to take their signs down and all that kind of stuff. And I said in our coffee moment a minute ago, I genuinely think that there's a compelling argument to sort of subsidise the universities, potentially subsidise the landlords, and just at least give something back to this generation who've been told to go here, go there, take this result, get this result, have it taken away, go to college, have no teaching. I mean, talk about value for money. If we're talking about market forces and we've turned the university education into a market commercial concept, they are not at the simplest level getting value for money.
They're not. Right, e-scooter. Jamal was banging on about this. I'm really worried about these e-scooters.
Yeah. I think they are... What's funniest about them is really cool people think they look cool, but they don't.
But the thing about them is, of course, they've been brought in for a good reason, because we're trying to get people to use their cars less, because we're trying to look after the planet.
Yeah.
But as any young person will tell you, they are used by drug dealers, for a start. It's a really, really good way of getting drugs passed around quickly. So apparently that's how your drugs arrive now, is on an e-scooter.
Wow.
So that's one thing. Silent getaway gadgets given free to lure kids to gangs.
They're very quiet.
We'll give you an e-scooter. You'll
quiet.
Be safe. Yeah. You will be able to get away from the police easily. And can you drop this off here and there? But also last week, lovely chap. Charity worker, I think he was in his 70s, was going down a hill just too fast, dead.
He was on one? Mm. Jesus.
They're dangerous things. Remember last 70? Week, we were talking about the poor woman who was knocked off into the river.
Now look, I have a lot of gripe. Me and Nadia wouldn't have met if it wasn't for the BBC. We sometimes call our children the greatest BBC production there ever was. but we met at the BBC, and I'm very fond of the BBC. Like most institutions, they have all sorts of problems, like ITV. And most institutions do, right? But Ofcom, which is the regulator of all, you know, our public service broadcasters, all channels, but also telecommunications or what have you, the government is allowed to install whoever is the head of Ofcom. And they essentially, a little bit like the high courts at the Supreme Court in America, they sort of dictate the tenor, tone and feel of British broadcasting. And what's most worrying about this is that the Prime Minister, Boris Johnson, has nominated two individuals to go become the head of Ofcom. One is probably, I think, the most evil man in the history of news gathering in this country, Paul Dacre, who was the man responsible for the Mail.
Oh.
And the Mail as we know it in its worst days, he founded it like that in its image. And Charles Moore, an Etonite who ran the Daily Telegraph.
Oh, God.
So we have two extraordinarily anti-public service broadcast. They'd say they're pro, but they're anti it because of the supposed left-leaning. For me, as a broadcaster, program maker, you know, with invested interest, having worked in the industry, this is the biggest worrying development for the future of the BBC. Now, we can argue about whether the license fee is too expensive. I think it is. I think it should go to pay-per-view. But I think it's, you know, it's impartiality, and what it's tried to do is something that's to be cherished in this country. Maybe its funding model needs to change, but we have to cherish that. But I worry now that as one paper puts it, Paul Dacre is like a knife in the heart, and the other one is like an injection of heroin in the veins. So it's kind of like, you know, we've got two, and they're the two only choices that Boris has put in there. So I worry for the future of the BBC.
Right, another bit of just nice stuff. This is an artist, amateur artist. What's called an amateur artist?
Does that mean you're not an artist?
I know. Hercule van Wolfwinkel is his name. I love that.
It's a good name.
And he does these great portraits of people's dogs. And I just thought that looks so like Chi-Chi.
Right.
That could have been Chi-Chi.
Which is, does he take the photo or does he do the drawing?
He does the drawing. Do you think that's cute? Mm, right.
And he's in, right, okay. I like that one. I like the little one with the chihuahuas.
Yeah, I love the chihuahuas.
Are they purposely naive?
Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I like that one.
Yeah, I quite like that one. It's a bit,
I was drawn
sort of...
to it, because actually why I was drawn to this, I thought, oh, God, there's Chi-Chi in the newspaper. Oh. But I know our subs will love this.
Yeah,
they love a pet
story. They love a pet story.
You love a pet story.
What do you make of this, Nad? Getting old and wrinkly really bugs millennials. Apparently, millennials are more worried than any other generation about getting wrinkles. An overwhelming 91% said they were worried about ageing, with facial lines being their biggest concern.
It's hardly surprising, is it, when all we ever talk about is that?
Is this all part of that sort of app filtering, making yourself look smooth,
yeah,
all that sort of stuff?
It's a problem. It's a
massive effing never thought about wrinkles until I was about 40.
There's people going into cosmetic surgeons asking to be made to look like however they look on their face app. Now, Prue Leith. I'm no prude Leith, says Prue Leith. Ex-wild child. I had no idea.
Oh,
the
I had this story,
was an
yeah.
ex-wild child.
I've got a great headline for this one. Hang on, look, I'll supplement it. I was bake off my head on LSD. I did like that headline.
Yeah, she's real sex, drugs and rock and roll. But she says taking LSD years ago was the most appalling experience she's ever had.
I'm pleased she says
and
that.
And she was having... I am... Oh, my God. That's the one thing I really pray that our girls never do. I
took it once, and I had the most awful experience on it. The most awful, awful, awful. People talk about it lightheartedly.
And it's very, very easy to get as well, apparently, but at the moment. But anyway, she had horrific hallucinations, and they continued on in until her 60s.
Right, yeah.
Until she was in her 60s.
They can really damage, you know, I think the idea of a crack on the brain, they can really, really damage you. I mean, people can get lost. Just, you know, and I had the most awful, I mean, it was just awful. I mean, to this day, if I think about it.
Well, I know somebody that I'm pretty damn sure their suicide was directly related to their acid use. Yeah, when they were younger. And, you know, on that note, personally, I think, and we've done a Confessions of a Modern Parent on this, and about how to talk to your kids about drugs. I just think it's really important that you do, that we do. Don't just shy away from it. And sometimes the way that we talk to our kids about it is, well, really casually, like there'll be a piece like this in the paper, and we'll say, and we know the kids are around, God, isn't that awful? Poor old Prue. She obviously had real fun when she was 18, but she's had nightmares right up until she's in her 60s. And that's just a way of getting it in without doing a big, heavy chat.
You are literally playing Russian roulette. Don't know who. It's Russian roulette. Yeah. If you're happy to put a gun up to your head not knowing whether the bullet's going to kill you, that's the risk.
Yeah, but that's a really good one to just chat about in front of the kids.
Well, especially as it's someone
And not with like an outrage, isn't it disgusting? She did drugs, she's going to, isn't that awful? All her life she had nightmares because of that.
But it's really good when I think that characters like Prue Leith and people in the mainstream like that talk about it, because, you know, it's a false narrative to say to youngsters today, no one does them, no one did them, I didn't do them. It's, come on, get real. I thought this would be a good one. I was shocked to hear that EastEnders viewing figures are down to 2.6 million. I remember the days when it was 26 million. The Queen Vic in
when you were there.
Yeah, that's probably why you're so ubiquitous. Here we go. Apparently, the Queen Vic could be going hipster with Walford set to get its own microbrewery. The soap's new 87 million set will get one to reflect the new East End of London. There's going to be a microbrewery. There's going to be hipsters with beards.
There'll be loads of wankers walking around.
Loads of wankers in tight trousers. In tight trousers and stupid beards. But look, they've called it Yeast Enders. I like that, Yeast Enders. Soap to get its own brewery. But here's beers they could make. Here's some of the names. Albert Ale, Old Speckled Den, Mitchell's Malt, The Queen Hick, Heinekenders. That's not very good.
COVID spray tips coach driver over the limit. Professional football team almost missed their match yesterday. They sprayed the coach with this alcohol spray. Then he has to, the driver did his automatic breathalyzer that you do, and it cut off the engine for 6 hours.
Oh shit.
Yeah.
Oh right, that's
so funny. They had to get cabs and bicycles and everything. Yeah. But they won in the end, 4-1 victory. So if you're using that alcohol spray, just be mindful of that. Don't overuse it in the car.
Also, rescue remedy. Incredibly alcoholic. Don't use it. Cakes and ale.
Don't use it if you have a problem with alcohol.
Yeah,
I use rescue remedy all the time.
So it should come with a warning. It's so strong, it can trigger me.
Do you know how much alcohol it's got in it?
It doesn't matter.
5%. That's interesting. It's because you're so not used to alcohol.
Yeah, but they do nothing to hide the taste.
They should say, actually.
They really should. I think it's outrageous.
You're right.
Cakes and ale. Here's a photo one. I thought you'd like this, Nads. Look at those pints. They're cakes.
Oh my God, that's so cool.
They're cakes. And look, they've got Battenberger, Spaghetto,
that's disgusting.
Baking and eggs. These are all cakes. Funday roast.
Regularly done.
Aren't they?
But they don't make you want to eat them.
Yeah, they look... No, I know what you mean. But you're like...
I don't want to cut into something that looks like a burger and then eat cake, but they're amazing to look at.
I kind of fancy a Guinness cake, though. There's something about cutting into that.
I wonder why.
Which would be nice. Sorry, I just caught a glimpse of that over there. Good God.
Trump, you know this, Trump last night, I don't know if you saw it, Mark and I watched it and it just gave us an eerie feeling, nominated Judge Amy Coney Barrett, 48 years old, to be the next Supreme Judge.
Yeah, we watched her sort of slightly.
Now, she is a member of the People of Praise. Now, this has been described as the sect that inspired the dystopian novel The Handmaid's Tale.
Whoa!
I mean, it's just absolutely petrifying.
That's frightening.
President Trump, oh God, he was up her arse like you wouldn't believe yesterday, called her a towering intellect and one of the most brilliant and gifted legal minds.
Mm.
Right, so somebody, there's a person here, Coral Thiel, who was a member of the People of Praise, and she said, I describe it as a cult. If I disagreed with my husband, I was abused, tortured, kidnapped and interrogated and psychologically abused.
Good God.
This is all allegedly.
Do you know what I thought when she was standing on the podium, though, and talking? What's the name of that group of women who are the perfectly behaved wives that you've talked about?
Surrendered wives. Yeah, and I the way she spoke there. About her husband. Yes. Him, my husband is the most incredible man. Yeah. My husband. And he was just sitting there. Just but anyway, Judge Barrett has refused to discuss her membership of the devout Catholic sect, but is widely seen as ultra-conservative on issues such as abortion and gay marriage. She will be Trump's third appointment if she gets
in. I know, it's quite something, isn't
God,
it?
God, it's so depressing.
Well, one just has to hope that the Senate doesn't... You know, they have to put her through all sorts of tests. Apparently, she has to be able to do the... she has to hula hoop, and she has to be able to do the limbo.
Okay.
If she can do that, she's in.
God, it could get that ridiculous, couldn't it?
Yeah, she has to do it in front of the Senate. COVID, we talked about this before. I was talking about it somewhere. I can't remember. Coffee moaning. That women between the ages of 25 and 29 are becoming the most infected category of people in the UK. And they seem to think that this is partly to do with the fact that they're in jobs that expose
more
them to risk, more face-to-face.
So retail,
that the viral load.
So, but these are young girls, young women that are being admitted to
These are going into hospital.
And
that's
maybe
worrying.
It's because of
that.
The viral load. Because, I mean, do we all remember Boris 2 months ago running up and down Westfield telling everyone to go shopping? Do we remember that?
Do we have footage of it?
In enclosed shopping centres where the viral load would be higher because there's no escape for it. I mean, I suppose they have filtration systems.
But our deaths per million residents are vastly less than Spain and France and Poland. It's not like, you know, we're not massively higher than Sweden.
Why are we so petrified? Why are we the most petrified
nation?
If I
see more graphs like that, all That's telling you completely graphs. Different stuff, it drives me nuts. Sophie Dahl. No,
doesn't she look so beautiful there?
God, do you remember when we had her on the
photograph of a beautiful woman. I didn't realise she's got two children now, 7 and 9.
Oh, yeah.
This is the photos. There's some sort of festive campaign, her and her husband. What's his name? Cullum.
Jamie Cullum.
Jamie Cullum, yeah. But I think she just looks absolutely beautiful. But look at everything. Look, she looks glum. She looks lost in thought.
She doesn't.
She's not enjoying. She just looks exquisitely beautiful. And that's
you did. I did a show with her years ago. She was lovely. It was one of those shots. I was on the camera that was filming her when we were interviewing her, and you couldn't quite believe the
her
face.
Beauty.
No.
Yeah.
It was almost alien-like. She was so beautiful.
Well, don't forget. They always say that supermodels are effectively aliens because they're so rare.
And of course she's the inspiration for the little girl in the BFG, isn't she? And I had the privilege of filming at Roald Dahl's cottage, her family making some food for her.
So just a quick one, apparently we're making tea, the way we are doing it is all wrong. We are not supposed
this.
To be making tea with boiling water. In fact, they're suggesting that we should put cold water on top of our tea bag before adding our boiling water. Apparently this dates back to when water was poisonous, and so we would boil it.
I think I'm inclined to agree.
No, but you can't. If you're going to do that, you've got to boil the kettle and then let it go down in. Don't not quite boil. But they're saying here you should only take it to 80 degrees. But I don't agree.
I sometimes flick the kettle off before it's boiled.
I don't like it.
But why should... Right. I heard somewhere that it's better for the flavour of the tea.
I put somewhere in here... Hang on a minute. This is all about selling those kettles that show you the degrees. But telling you now, that would be what it's about. It's some kind of marketing ploy.
So this is a good one. I thought this might resonate. This is my last one. Lots of celebrities are doing these like £35 sort of message on Instagram. Lots of people just to supplement in harsh times an income, you know, it's understandable.
I'd like to do that and give it to charity.
But here's the thing.
Nobody might want it.
Sooty is selling messages in the same way.
I did Panto with Sooty.
That's why I chose him.
He had a bigger dressing room than me.
Apparently he's the most cooperative co-presenter you've ever worked with, isn't he? That's what I've heard. Yeah. But the funny thing, of course, is Nutty and Sweep. The headline in The Sun is, he must be poor, P-A-W. There is an assumption that if you're doing this, you haven't got much money. But I don't think that's very nice when a lot of actors are having to do this as a means to kind of make ends meet.
Exactly, I think it's great.
But the weird thing about Sooty is that he's selling messages for £35, but of course he can't speak. He didn't say anything.
So what's he doing?
Well, apparently...
His little squeakies.
Yeah, absolutely. So... a blurb on the Celeb VM website reads, Sooty and Sweet would be delighted to deliver personal messages. Sooty celebrated his 70th birthday 2 years ago. He's the same age as Nanny Di. He looks a bit like Nanny Di, doesn't he? I'd love you just to reply to a
give
text.
Give it to mind. Give
just
it to mind.
To a text.
Why not?
Would be
why
really
don't
you
give
nice.
It to mind?
Why don't you just answer me sometimes?
Right, I'm going to be really quick with this, but I really, really want you guys to just go to mailonsunday.co.uk, Save Our Farms.
This is my love, man.
Or Defend Our Farms. This is all about the fact that we are going to be bringing in, I've talked about this a number of times here on the Sunday Show, haven't I? Due to Brexit,
chicken.
Post-Brexit, we will be allowing food in, very cheap food, that actually Europe did not allow us to bring in because it was so toxic. I've spoken about this. Mm. Chlorinated chickens, all this sort of stuff. Now, it is going to decimate our farmers' business here. It really, really is, because if you can get stuff in really cheap, people are going to be broke, people are going to do it. But a number of celebrities and other people have put together a letter. Your Joe is there, Joe Rich is in there, Jamie Oliver, Anita Rani. Wish they'd asked me, I would have signed that letter.
They are sooty.
Asking them to be really, really mindful about what they're doing here. Think about children's health. Think about the quality of food. Mm. Think about obesity. Think about all these things before you sign these trade deals. And if we support our farms, eventually people will come to buy British. Mm. And actually, it could be really good for the economy. So if you want to just sign this petition, Mark, you have to sign it as well. mailonsunday.co.uk/defendourfarms /saveourfarms. I think it's really, really important.
Very important.
The world will buy British, Boris, if you back our farmers.
Well, there you go. And let's face it, Nadia has been banging the drum for things like vitamin D. What else? Something else. It all comes to light eventually. The thing I've learned in life is when you're married to a woman to like Nadia, listen to it.
Oh, Nadia, oh, Nadia, oh, have you met Nadia? Nadia, the tattoo lady.
Have you got a beard as well?
Oh, got a little one coming there.
What's your favourite cake, Dad?
My favourite?
Yeah.
Toast?
Cake.
What are you talking about?
What's your favourite cake? Cake.
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 Cake. T-A-K-E? What, cake, yeah?
Cake? Where's your cake hole?
Oh, cake hole! A cake hole is something different.
What's your favourite cake?
It's any cake is good.
Ah.
At tea time, though.
Ah, there you go. There we have it. So it's a jolly good job that your poll, because we put a poll out, suggested that your favourite cake is a Black Forest Gatto. So that's what we're going to have now. A big, fat, triple-layered Black Forest Gatto.
Yeah?
You're not. There's none for you.
Why not?
Because Lisa's eating it all.
What's happening to Lisa's? Oh, my God. I did a poll earlier on my Instagram earlier on in the week. Would you like me to do a pineapple upside down cake or a Black Forest Gatto? And you guys win the Black Forest Gatto. I feel a bit bad actually, because I think a lot of people thought I was going to do it on Instagram, but it's just the family guests that get it.
Oh.
Oh well. So I've got my oven on at 160 degrees because I'm cooking it in the fan.
Right.
I've got my 3 20-centimeter tins greased with these funky little things that make sure the cake comes out. Here I've got 175 grams of butter and 75 grams of chocolate.
Ooh.
And I'm just going to let that just melt down. Right, I've written up the ingredients here, so I just want to read them out. Should you get a pen and paper?
Got a pen and paper.
Okay, so that was 175 grams of butter, 75 grams of dark chocolate, 300 grams of plain flour, 350 grams of caster sugar, yes, it's dangerous, this. 25 grams of cocoa, 1 teaspoon of bicarb, 2 eggs, and 200 grams of plain yogurt. So you can just give this a stir.
So did you know that the Black Forest Gatto is actually of German descent?
Yes, I did actually, as in the Black Forest.
Yeah, but guess what the nature of the Black Forest Gatto comes from?
What?
Apparently the cherry trees were planted by romantic couples. So it's a very romantic cake.
Do you know, my mum one Christmas bought me a whole load of a cherry orchard. Well, not cherry orchard. You invest some money and then you can go, you know, you pay 100 quid and then you can go and pick as many cherries as you like.
That's lovely. The history of the cherry element comes from romantic couples.
I love that. Black Forest Gâteau. Almost there. Doesn't take long. Take it off the heat. Let it cool down a bit.
Every Black Forest Gâteau I had as a child had lots of cream on the outside.
No, it won't have cream on the outside. Because I tell you why, it doesn't photograph
with
well.
Alcohol.
We've got cream all around it. You want to see the layers of cream in between.
Does yours
chocolate.
Have alcohol in it?
Kish. Okay, so we've got our flour. We add our sugar. I've already given you the measurements. Now that's a mixture of white and golden cast sugar because I didn't have 350 grams of golden cast sugar. Cocoa. 2 medium eggs. Did I say 1 teaspoon of bicarb when I gave you the measurement subs?
I don't know.
I don't think I did. So there's a teaspoon of bicarb as well. Bicarb helps it rise. If anyone could tell me why we use bicarb instead of baking powder.
What is bicarb?
In a Black Forest Gâteau, I would love to know. But you use it as a raising agent. I use it in falafels.
It must be the carbonated product, byproduct of salt. Because it's bicarbonate of soda.
Put my yogurt and eggs into
yogurt
the middle.
I love Black Forest Gâteaus. They always make me smile. Some people don't like them, do they?
They don't like the kirsch.
Yeah, I love the kirsch. I love the cherries.
And now I'm going to add my chocolate.
Ooh.
And butter.
Ooh, I say.
And 100 mils of boiling water.
Oh, Mr. Wala.
You've never seen a cake like this, have you?
No.
I really wanted to use the electric whisk because it's much easier, but I know you get so annoyed with the sound. And now I'm paying the price.
It will get there.
Look at that. Oh, God, it smells so good. It's a shame because Kiki would love this chocolate cake, but she won't like the alcohol flavour. Oh, it's so rich. It's so good. I think the bicarb and the yogurt reacts, has a chemical reaction. Which does something to the cake.
It's a chemical reaction.
Okay, that's ready.
Wow, I'd say that's really easy. I might watch this back to make it.
Oh my God.
So good.
Mmm, it's next level.
Is it next level?
Oh, quite a good idea to use a ladle so you can put it equally.
Pat a cake, baker's man. Bake me a cake as fast as you can.
Pat it and prick it and
mark it with D.
No, 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 oven for baby and me. Make sure you grease your pans well, girls.
Oh, yeah.
And boys.
What, before you go out on a Friday night?
Look, that was worked out brilliantly.
Oh.
Two ladles.
Oh,
two ladles
that.
Each.
Three cow pats.
Oh my God, look at me, I've got flour all over.
Aren't they nads? They're like three cow pats.
Oh, Mark, don't say that. Why do you have to say that when I'm cooking?
Mm.
It's disgusting.
But no one's going to eat a cow pat.
No, but you don't understand. Oh God, I can't get these. They're stuck together.
We used to throw frozen cow pats at each other.
In fact, we're putting this in the oven, and then guess what we're doing next? Because this is Friday night, we're doing the live with you guys.
Members live!
It's almost 9 o'clock. It has been a long day. Yummy, 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 I love my tummy and be a whole.
Right!
There we go.
Tell me again.
160 fan or 180 normal.
Nice to be told again so you don't have to go scrolling.
I think it's about 25 minutes. Oh, it's gone off! Oh, shit!
Oh, no!
That's a real pain. Because now it has to
can
go in when
sink?
It's hot. Oh, yeah. Because what happens is the bicarb and everything is reacting.
Oh,
now.
No. It's all going on in there right now. Tick tock, tick tock, tick tock, tick tock, tick tock.
Hopefully, it's still hot enough.
What are we going to do, Nads?
It was on when we started. It's hot. So annoying.
Took your eye off the ball, babe.
Cook's privileges. Come on. Okay, we have lipped on. So in they go for 25 minutes. You might have to, at 20 minutes, move them around a bit if you've got them on different shelves, if you've got a smaller oven. Hopefully they'll fit in.
Dance like a Kirsch.
No, I can't dance like
Kirsch. Dance like a Kirsch.
They're not dancing tonight.
Dance like a cherry.
Sorry. If you saw the members live on Friday, you saw that I got this cake out whilst we were live. Oh, look. Oh, these things, I absolutely love them. Oh, this smells so good, so rich. Wow, I need to get another tray. There we go. And I'm not going to layer them up till tomorrow because I thought I had some cherries in Kirsch and I haven't. So I've got to go and buy some.
Go on then. I'll do this tomorrow.
I'll be in different clothes. It'll be the morning. I'll do it differently tomorrow. So it's the next morning, and my mum, thank God you had a jar of cherries in natural juice. They're not in Kirsch, but I have Kirsch here, so that's fine, because that's the alcohol.
What is Kirsch?
It's a cherry liqueur.
Oh,
yeah. So, the cakes are obviously nice and cooled, because we cooked them yesterday. Now, I am going to have such a drama, because I've got to pile the cake here so it looks lovely for our photos, but then I've got to get it in here to take it to Lisa's. Does anyone think I'm going to manage it?
No. It's going to be in pieces.
Oh, don't. I really want to take them a nice cake. Okay, so I need 100 mils of this cherry juice. So I'm just going to pour these cherries. Look at that. They're just in a lovely syrup. Oh, my God, that's going to be nice. Yeah. So I'm just going to get 100 mils. Two teaspoons of Kirsch. Okay, I'm just gonna put some holes. Mark won't be having this. Because it's going to Lisa, so that's why I've got the raw alcohol in. But you don't have to put the alcohol in, just put this cherry juice because it gives that really moist cake. So I've got 50 grams of icing sugar, I've got 500 mils of double cream. This is a special cake, don't forget. This isn't something you have every week. There's a lot of cream, a lot of sugar, just every so often. It's lovely to have. And a teaspoon of good vanilla extract. So I've turned my whisks down now because it's thickening up and I just want it billow. I want billowing cream. I mess this up all the time, you know. It's a really big fear of mine, cream, because I always overbeat it. Now, I mean, people, proper bakers and cooks will be going, oh God, you're ages from it over-thickening, but I get really worried about it. Just finishing off with the hand whisk now, so it doesn't get too thick. Mark, don't keep that in. See how much
yeah.
Attention I'm paying this. Billowy cream is what we want. Okay.
Constructing.
Like.
Oh, the Airfix kit for cake.
I'm just going to put a really thin layer of jam just around the edge like that. Just realised something. What? It's going to be too high with the cream to get in the tin to take to Lisa's.
Oh, you're going to leave it with me.
No.
No wonder I like Black Forest Ghetto and a trifle. I'm a bloody alcoholic. Mm. And rum bar bars. I've just realised.
No, everything with alcohol in it.
Oh my God.
Last one. Oh. What are we thinking, guys? How are you going to take it to Lisa's?
You can't. And you're not going to. This could be my relapse cake.
Could we please have a photograph it in case I ruin it with the chocolate? God, I'm scared, guys. I don't know whether to do the chocolate on top. What do you reckon? I'm just crumbling a flake. Because only the crumbliest, flakiest chocolate ever tasted like a chocolate before. Is that what they say? What do they say?
Only the crumbliest, flakiest chocolate balls taste
like chocolate never tasted before. Yeah, that's it. Right, I am really worried that this is going to spoil the look of it.
I'm not. It's milky coloured compared to the dark joy of this.
What do you think? Do you think I should just put it in the middle? Yeah. Or do you think, shall I put it round the edge? No, oh, it's hard, isn't it? Or just all over? Shall I just do it? Only the crumbliest, flakiest chocolate tastes like chocolate never tasted before.
The lightness of the milk chocolate is reflected in the lightness of the sponge.
Okay. I'm not going to go all the way. I'm going to leave that creamy, the cream. It's hard, these decisions, you know?
That's nice.
I think it looked nicer without.
I don't.
Yeah. What do you reckon, Subs? Would you have put the chocolate or not? Were you screaming at me, don't put the chocolate? Only the crumbliest, flakiest chocolate tastes like chocolate never tasted before. I think we are going to the memes, no we're not, to the book. Don't worry, I'll film it in the vlog, cutting it open. Jesus, that is a cake and a half.
Turn to review the book today, and it's Matt Haig's The Midnight Library. He also wrote those sort of philosophical books like Reasons to Stay Alive, Notes on a Nervous Planet. So The Midnight Library, Matt Haig does a lot of sort of social media and talks and writing about mental health issues, and at one point in his life he sadly tried to take his life. And I think this book very much is a working out of what happened back there when he felt suicidal. This is a book about a character called Nora Seed. Nora Seed was an aspirant sort of musician. We pick up her story when she's very sort of near the end of her sort of present day life. And it's very neatly and sort of rather sort of portentously and slightly ominously written along the lines of 7 days before she decided to die, Nora did da 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 da. And so you have this sense right at the beginning of the book that there is an incoming disaster. And it doesn't give anything away to let you know what that initial spoiler is. So the Midnight Library is a place that when she, in whatever form she potentially finds herself close to death, she enters the Midnight Library, which I suppose a sort of meaningful grab on it would be, it's like a place of limbo. It's like a limbo place where you go to, at that point, a sort of waiting room. Sometimes it would make me think of that scene in Beetlejuice, you know, when all those characters were sort of sitting around when they just died and they were sort of almost waiting to be checked in. But in this Midnight Library, a character called Mrs. Elm, who was the librarian of Nora's when she was a child at primary school, is there in a sort of spiritual sense, guiding her or introducing her to the fact that there are countless millions and millions of books in this library, all of which are the potential lives you could have lived. And this is quite a philosophical book.
it deals with that whole sort of quantum physics, quantum mechanics idea that at every point in our life, with every choice we make, not even every choice we make, but every infinitesimal thing we do, my hand doing that or not doing that, that there are countless other versions of our lives pursued or that could have been pursued or sort of oscillating and operating alongside the life that we chose. And so this is a book about what ifs. This is a book about potentially test driving, potentially living, potentially standing in the shoes of all those lives we thought we could have lived. And it is quite a compelling read. It's quite a sort of slight conceit that when you let yourself go to it, it's a bit like a fable. It's a bit like it reminded me of, at times, of almost a sort of one of the Arabian Nights stories, a kind of story that Neddy's dad would really like. And so in this sort of mystical, magical, netherworldly kind of limbo midnight library, Nora is encouraged to read the Book of Regrets, which is a book of all the things she wished she'd done better, perhaps, you know, aches over the fact that she didn't do this or make this choice in her life. And then she's allowed to open books that allow her to literally land in her body in the life she hadn't lived or didn't live and test drive it, in a sense, be in it. And there are many different lives that she sort of steps into. The life of being a successful pop star, the life of being a glaciologist, someone who works in the Arctic, analysing the sort of climate change in the Arctic. She comes back working in a sort of rescue home for dogs. There's another one where she comes back as an Olympiad swimmer, and she's managed by her brother. And then there's another one where she comes back and she's actually, it's a perfect life. She's married to a man that she's always sort of harbored sort of feelings for. She has a child, and it's almost the life that she couldn't have ever imagined having. And so she test drives all the lives, and they all have elements about them that you think, oh yeah, you know, Matt Haig does a brilliant job of parking you behind Nora's head and heart so that you feel that sort of thing of, oh yeah, that's why I want this. But then in each life, you realize there's some sacrifice, there's some element of the life that she's got or that she tried to get rid of in, you know, at the beginning of the book. There's some element of her life that she loses in every other life she test drives. You know, either it be a relative, a friend, a partner, you know, someone that, or a parent. There's a sacrifice that has to be made, even in the perfect lives that she perhaps could have pursued. And so the book builds philosophically. It sort of made me at times nostalgic for all those thoughts that we all have. We all live our lives thinking, well, what if I'd done that? What if I'd gone that route? What if I'd taken that route? And you never get the chance to really retread that path. But he brings it round beautifully, Matt Haig, full circle, to a realization that whilst we may not have lived literally all of those lives, the potentiality of all of those lives is real. And so there's a beautifully sort of, I don't know if it's Buddhist, but there's a very cleansing and cleaning and very sort of spiritually reassuring sense that even in the test driving of all these lives that in a sense run down cul-de-sacs and she has to return and she ends up abandoning them and returning back to the Midnight Library and choosing another life, all of them, the seeds of all of them are in the woman in the bedsit at the beginning of the book, who feels that there's no choices and there's no life to be had. And so it's a book about gratitude. It's a book about recovery. It's a book about taking stock and realizing that whatever what the limitations of one's life is, if we had the luxury of being able to do it quite literally like this, we'd realize that it's part of the human condition to forever want something more or feel that there's something insufficient. There are constant sacrifices and trade-offs that are made in every life that we could live, so that those that we've made in this life don't look so sort of blunt or harsh, because actually, whatever life we have to make huge sacrifices. Of course, the frustration, if there's a frustration with the book, is that do we do this? Could we do this? I mean, Matt Haig's almost made me want to believe that this is what happens on one's deathbed. This is the equivalent of one's life flashing before you. It's not one's life flashing before you. It's all the other lives you thought you were going to live or that you could have lived or that have been lived in a quantum mechanics, quantum physics sort of way, all of which reconfirm to you that the life you have lived was the life worth living. And I think in that, there's something amazing. There's
There's some real, really emotional moments in here. The character of Nora, I really felt I was in her, I was alongside her. Matt Haig worked beautifully as a woman, you know, a female character. You felt her sense of love. You felt the sense of completion she got when she had a child and the partner that she wanted in one of these lives. And then you felt that desperately difficult element of suffering from depression, which is, however good things are, they're still not good enough. And could they still be better? And all of that. It's a great book. It makes you think of all those sort of plots and films, sliding doors, what if we could choose this, what if we could choose that. But what I thought was clever about it was it took us down all those what ifs and then firmly closed the book, if you like, on any real need to sort of feel like, you know, any regret that you didn't live those lives. I'd fully recommend this. It's a really meaningful, really moving and really clever read that will make you think a lot about the life you're living, the life you've lived, the life you could have lived, and how they are all inextricably entwined.
So, it is time for Teddy Talks! Sorry, my voice is gone. Anyway, here he is. I'm going to turn the camera around. And what's it about today?
Oh, it's very weird.
It's very weird. Yeah. I'll turn the camera around. So, Teddy Talk, what's it about today?
Well, it's about a Libyan accountant who was a crook. Years ago, he nicked about, you know, 5-6 million of the public purse and ran off to London. Being a crook with money, London received him with open arms, of course. And he got married to an English lady and he produced a son and a daughter. And one day he felt it was safe for him to return for some business or other and they grabbed him.
Oh, return to?
To Libya.
Uh-huh.
And they caught him and put him under investigation, jailed him under investigation.
Is this someone you knew?
Yes.
Uh-huh, okay.
Yes. And he was trying, you know, all kinds of tricks to try and release himself from jail. He sort of knew Gaddafi in a way. He had good contacts there, and they were all, at the time, they were all thieves. And eventually, he received a letter from his English wife with a photograph of his son Muhammad playing Jesus Christ in a nativity play.
Oh my God.
Him being so clever, thought, right. So he went to the management of the jail, you know, and he said, look, my son Muhammad, they are turning him into a Christian. What? How's that? He said, see, they have dressed him as Jesus Christ. And they said, Muhammad is Jesus Christ. We can't be doing with that, he said. So it even got to Gaddafi. And he said, what? Oh, Muhammad playing Jesus Christ? No way, he said. So this crook said, release me, send me back home on a mission to save my son Muhammad from the wiles of the Christians. He said, of course, release him, but first make him sign that once he has saved his son, he will return to Libya.
And go back to prison?
And back to investigation, yeah.
Okay.
About it. And so they made him sign and swear on the religious, all the religious books and everything, and that he would, you know, grab his son. I think they lived in barns at the time. And he'd grab his son and take him back to Libya and so save him from the wiles of the Christians. And he, you know, got to the airport, flew back to London, straight with his wife and his children to Cornwall, where he bought himself about a house for about 5 million.
Wow.
And he's still living there, very happy man. Gaddafi got killed, the world changed, and he's a happy man. What do you think of that? Eh? Alarm over nothing, really. The boy was just playing in a nativity play. But he used this as a wonderful excuse for him to get out of jail, to save his son from the wiles of the Christians. It's an amazing story, but it's true.
God.
It is true.
And do you still know him?
I haven't seen him for a long time, you know. But
what sort of a person was he?
You know, you think dodgy people like that have some kind of a sign saying that they're dodgy, but they're not. You know, very simple, naive-looking fella, but calculating.
Cunning.
He knows how to be cunning, yeah.
Yeah.
Because he lived in a cunning environment.
And so what would you say the moral of the story is?
The moral of the story is that as a human race, you know, we really have very few true principles, you know. Mm-hmm. We'll use religion, we'll use our grandmothers, we'll use our mothers, you know, to get advantage in life.
And do you think at this time in the world, more so than ever, from where you sit?
Well, I come from a different culture, darling. It's a new culture. It's a culture which is basically, it's a spiritual culture, but it has been turned by modern circumstances into an extremely materialistic place, you know? And that's, I did a film, and I told you about, you know, Captain Amurai. And I loved that film because there was this man, the man I played, was a man who had principle, and he had some kind of a spirituality, seeing the world through spiritual eyes. Mm. And although, you know, we come to the West for more money, the West is going to us looking for spirituality, but we have none because we've become so materialistic. And This man is a first-class example. You know, he will use religion, he will use political contacts, he will use money, he'll use anything to get advantage in life, to get material advantage. Mm. Spiritual advantage, forget it. Mm. Doesn't exist. Anyway, it just fascinated me. I thought I'd share it with our friends. Mm.
Yeah.
What?
You'll have to tell me when I turn this off who it is. How's your heartbeat, by the way?
No, I'm fine now.
So, Dad?
Yes?
What did you think of the show?
I'm going to tell a very weird story.
No, hang on. No, not yet. This is the end of the show. Say thank you, everybody, for a wonderful show.
Oh, thank you, everybody, for a wonderful show.
We'll see you next week, guys. Say bye. More Teddy Talks. Say bye, Dad. Say bye.
Bye-bye.